Roundtable Films is very privileged to introduce Dr. L. Dale Kaufman. Dr. Kaufman has been Dean of the Vanderbilt Law School and is the founder and first Dean of the UCLA Law School. He is a member of the American Arbitration Association and currently serves as an arbitrator in a wide variety of labor disputes.
You're about to see a film entitled A Case of Insubordination. There are really three films purporting to depict the same event through the eyes of three people. First, Joe, the elderly employee involved, Frank, the young, tall supervisor, and Larry, the vending machine company employee who witnessed the whole thing. Each one of these three films shows the same event, which occurred right in this room, in a slightly different light, but the differences are quite material. Every trial lawyer knows that many times his hardest task is to find out just what happened. The facts, not the law, many times give him the most trouble. The same problem sometimes faces management in dealing with labor relations and grievances. Of course, many grievances are concerned with the meaning and interpretation of labor agreements, but because the language of such agreements varies so much from company to company and from union to union, we have tried to present a problem for management that could arise under almost any labor agreement. This is essentially a fact question. If six people witness an automobile accident, every trial lawyer knows that he will probably get six different versions of just what happened. Then the parties involved will probably have still different stories. These people may not be lying. They just see the same happening through different eyes. Now, let us see if we can tell what actually did happen.
Joe?
What is it, Frank?
I knew I'd find you in here.
Huh? What's the matter?
I need your help on something.
Sure. What is it?
Steve's in a bind. Needs a hand right now and for the rest of the week.
Oh.
Well, would you want to go over and help him?
Well, I see.
I know it means working as an assistant, but you're the only one available, and it's only for a short while.
You know, I'd be very glad to help you out, but, well, I'm waiting for Bob to meet me here. Hey, you're looking at the winner of the World Series pool. Bob's coming with my dough, so maybe you can get someone else, huh?
I might ask if you read the notice on gambling.
Oh, come on, Frank. Now, wait a minute. I've been here 30 years. That's a lot longer than you, and every year, as far back as I can remember, we've had a World Series pool.
Gambling is gambling.
Well, now, this is the first pool that I've won. I intend to collect it. Look, Steve has a good crew. Why can't they handle their own work? Why is he always asking someone to help him?
Let's stick to the point, Joe.
Well, I just remembered. I can't go down there anyway.
Why not?
Because I'm still in the middle of that Kansas City job for Bill, and I want to get on it right after this break. There's a couple of very important reports that I've still got to make out.
Okay, well, don't worry about that. Kansas City is not that urgent.
No, just the same. Bill's the foreman. I don't think I should go leave one job in the middle without his knowing what's going on.
Well, I'm the supervisor here. Both Bill and Steve work for me. I'll see that Bill knows what it's all about.
Oh, now look, you sound upset. Are you telling me I have to go down there? Because if you are, say no more, I'm on my way.
No. I'm just asking you to help out.
Well, now let me level with you. When Steve says that he needs me now and for the rest of the week, that could be for months. I know him. I used to work for him.
So that's it. You got it in for Steve, and that's why you don't want to help him.
Well, no, it's not only me. There's nobody around here who'd give that guy the time of day except you.
Now, I'm telling you, keep his personality out of this. Whenever one of my foremen says he needs something, that's good enough for me.
Well, maybe that's your problem. Maybe you ought to ask yourself, why is he in trouble right now? I'll tell you why. Because the people who work for him haven't got any respect for him. That's why. They just don't put out for him. And the minute he leaves the area, they goof off.
Now look, Joe, I just told you, Steve's one of my foremen, and I'm not about to discuss him with you. It's not your business.
Oh, yes, it is. Now look what you're asking me to do because of him. You're asking me to do the kind of work I did years ago. I tell you, I've had my fill of that kind of work. It's too hard and it's dirty. Why should I do it for him anyway? I ask you, wouldn't the company be a lot better off if they found out once and for all that Steve's not qualified? I mean, why should I pull his chestnuts out of the fire for him?
It's in the same department, Joe. We're all in the same team.
Not Steve. He's the only man on his team.
Okay, Pop, you got all the answers.
I got you. And I'll tell you something else. If Steve were the supervisor and you were his foreman, you know what he would do? He'd tell you, sorry, Frank, I really tried to get you a man, but there's just nobody else available. I guarantee you that.
Yeah, but I guarantee you there's one thing I'm not going to do any longer, and that's get down on my hands and knees and beg you to give Steve a hand.
Well, what are you going to do?
I'm not just going to sit still for this, believe me.
Well, wait a minute. Now, don't get sore. I just think you're making a very unreasonable request.
Oh, you do? Well, isn't that sweet? Now, you get up out of that chair right now, and you get over to Steve. Now, does that sound reasonable enough to you? Come on, I said get moving.
Take your hands off me here.
Come on, Pop.
Now, look, you take your hands off me. You don't have any right to push me around. If I were only 10 years younger, I'd...
Come on, now. I'm not pushing you. I'm just trying to be friendly and help you on your way.
You keep your cut and take your hands off of me. Now, look what you've done. I warned you.
You warned me? Now, that's a laugh. Okay, Pop, now get moving.
I better clean this mess up before somebody gets hurt.
No, you don't. You leave that mess right there. And you hustle your aching little back over to Steve's right now, and you do exactly what he tells you for the rest of the week, or until he says he's through with you. Then, and only then, you report back to me. Now, that's the kind of talk you understand, right?
You rough me up, and you expect me to do what you say? Well, I got news for you. I'm filing a grievance right now, and you're not going to scare me off, sonny boy, no matter how rough you get.
You want to see just how rough I can get, huh? All right, I'm putting you up for insubordination. Now, how does that grab you?
Nobody will ever believe you.
No? Well, we'll see about that. Now, right now, you go home for the rest of the day. We'll talk about this tomorrow when the department manager's off.
Larry, did you see what happened?
Yeah.
Will you be my witness?
Well, I don't like to get mixed up in these things.
Well, you don't have to. You don't even work here.
No, but...
Well, what do you say, Larry?
Well, I guess I have to. I'm the only one around.
Thanks.
Oh, there you are.
Well, what is it, Johnny? What's the matter?
I'm glad I phoned you.
Oh?
I've been looking all over for you. Steve's in a bind. He needs some help right now and for the rest of the week.
Well, what else is new?
I'd like you to go down there and help him out.
Well, look at me. I'm not going anywhere.
Well, why not, Joe?
First of all, because I'm taking a break. More important, I just won my first World Series pool. So I'm bobbing on his way over here with his money, and then... I'm going to stay right here until he puts that door in my hot little hand.
Now, you know as well as I do, Joe, that no money can exchange hands on the premises. That's gambling.
Oh, come on, Frank. This kind of gambling has been going on for 30 years. Just take my advice and don't make waves.
Why do you want to find some other center to help Steve?
I said I'd like you to do it.
Well, I'm sorry. I just remembered I can't go anyway, even if I wanted to.
Now what excuse have you got?
No excuse. It's just that I'm right smack in the middle of that Kansas City job for Bill.
Oh, you are? Well, I know all about that, and it's not that important.
That's what you say. But Bill told me that this Kansas City job has top priority. I work for him. After all, he's my foreman.
I happen to be the supervisor here. Both Bill and Steve work for me, so I'll let Bill know exactly what I'm doing. So, would you be good enough to go over there right now, please?
Now, just a minute. You don't have any right to ask me to do a thing like that. I mean, that's working as an assistant. Besides, it's hard work and it's dirty. Look, I had my fill of that kind of work when I was young.
It's only for the rest of the week.
The rest of the week. That's what Steve tells you. But I know him.
You got something against Steve?
You bet. I used to work for him. You know the reputation he's got.
I don't want to hear about that.
That's time you wised up. I wouldn't give that guy the right time. And even with anyone else around here. His own people don't put out for him. That's why he needs help.
There are very good reasons why Steve needs help, but I don't intend to discuss them with you. Besides, we all get a little in a bind once in a while, so why make such a big deal out of it? Just get in there and give him a hand. We're all working for the same company.
Not him. He's working for Steve. So I say, let top management find out about him. We keep helping him. They'll never know what a lousy foreman he really is.
I told you I don't want to discuss Steve with you. He asked me if I could get him someone, and I said I would. You are both qualified and available. So I'm telling you again, go over there and help him out.
And I say forget it. Just tell Steve you couldn't find anyone. I mean, Supposing I wasn't available.
But you are available. Besides, I don't do things that way.
Believe me, that's what he'd tell you, son.
Then you refuse to do it?
Yeah. Yeah, you want favors like this? Send money.
Okay, Pop, that's the way you want it.
When it comes to that kind of dirty work, and for him, that's the way I want it.
All right. I'm warning you, then. I'll have to put you up for insubordination. So it's up to you. Look, now, Pop, let's not make a big deal out of this. Now, come on, Joe. You know we've always got along. You can help out this once. Come on now, Joe.
Don't push me. Now, you keep your hands to yourself.
There you go. Now, look what you've done.
I've done? I was only trying to be friendly, but I don't think you understand what being friendly really is.
Well, I got news for you. I may be an old man, but no kid like you is going to con me into doing something I don't want to do. You understand?
I understand. So now I'm giving you your last chance.
Well, go ahead.
You listen to me, Joe, and you listen carefully because I've had just about all I'm going to take from you. I was telling you to do something in a nice, polite way before, but you don't appreciate that kind of relationship, do you?
Well, the nicest thing you could do for me right now, sonny boy, is get lost.
Hold on, Joe. Now, you either go down to Steve's and help him out for the rest of the week and get moving this instant, or else.
Or else what?
I'm sending you home. Now, it's up to you.
Now, you do that. Because I'm not taking orders from anybody who shows me around. And for your information, Mr. Supervisor, the use of physical force on an employee is cause for a grievance.
And you're not going to help out?
No. I'm going home. Just like you said.
You bet you are, and we'll discuss it all tomorrow morning. You report to the department manager's office. Oh, Larry.
Yeah?
I was wondering, did you see what just happened?
Yeah, I sure did.
You mean you saw everything?
Well, nobody sees everything.
It would be very helpful if we had a witness.
No, nobody can make it if you don't want it.
Look, I don't like to get mixed up in these kind of things. But I guess I have to. I'm the only one in here.
I'm waiting for Bob. He's on his way over here.
Well, what's so important about meeting Bob?
Well, I just won my first World Series pool in 30 years, and he's bringing me the good news, huh?
Oh, Joe, you know if any money changes hands, that's gambling.
Oh, come on, Frank. Now, after 30 years of working here, you're not going to tell me about the rules. I wrote the book.
I'm sorry, but the World Series is over, and Bob's not about to skip town. So how about going over to help Steve, huh?
Well, I can't anyway.
Why not?
Well, because I've been working on a Kansas City job for Bill, and, well, it's not finished, and I don't want to leave right in the middle of it. I thought I'd get right back on it after this break.
Well, Kansas City is really not that urgent.
Well, what have I been breaking my back on it all morning?
I don't know, but it's really not that important.
But Bill said it was. I work for him. He's my foreman.
Look, I'm the supervisor here. Both Bill and Steve work for me. I know exactly what they're working on, and I say it's more important for you to give Steve a hand right now.
Oh, then, you'll tell Bill, huh?
Of course. So now, once again, won't you go over and help Steve out?
Frank, I'd rather not. You know, it's dirty work, and I had my fill of that kind of work when I was younger.
It's hard, I know, but you can do it.
Sure, I can do it, but, well, it means that working as an assistant after 30 years, it's a little unreasonable, isn't it?
It's only for the rest of the week. That won't kill you.
Only for the rest of the week. You believe that?
That's what Steve asked for, and that's all I'm authorizing.
Well, that's what he says now, but what's going to happen when the end of the week comes and he says he still needs me? I know what's going to happen. I used to work for him.
What do you mean? You got something against Steve?
Well, you know the reputation he's got.
No, I don't, and I'm not interested in hearing about it. Not from you.
There's nobody around here to give that guy the time of day.
I don't deal in personalities. Steve's one of my foremen, and when he says he needs help, if I can, I'd get it for him. That way I help him, the company, and all of us.
I don't agree with that, no. Now, it's time the company found out about him. If his own people aren't putting out and he gets into trouble, and if he's not qualified to be a foreman, then management ought to know about it.
That may be, but right now he's in a jam, so I'll try and help him. That's all I can do.
No, that's not all you can do. You can go to him and say, sorry, Steve, but nobody's available.
But you are both qualified and available.
Believe me, that's what he'd tell you if he was supervisor.
Well, I'm not built that way. I do my job my way. I try to be fair with everybody.
And why aren't you being fair with me?
I was, but with some people, they say it just doesn't pay to be nice.
Look, Frank, don't get sore. I've been talking to him a long time.
Okay, let's not make a big deal out of this. We've always gotten along, haven't we?
We have.
All right, then help us out, bud. Come on, down.
Now look what you've done.
What I've done?
Yeah, that's right. You started it.
Okay, Pop. I asked you to go over and help Steve out, and you refused to go. Now I'm putting you up for insubordination.
First you rough me up, then you expect me to go. You call that insubordination? Well, you know you're not allowed to use physical force on an employee. That's cause for a grievance everywhere, and you can bet your life I'm going to file it.
You call that roughing you up? You never really seen me rough anybody up, have you? Well, I hardly touched you. Now, I told you I was trying to be friendly. Now, you either go over and see Steve, and I mean right now, or else.
Or else what?
Or else you go home, and we'll talk about this tomorrow in the department manager's office.
That's fine with me. I'll see you tomorrow. I hope you saw what happened, Larry. I want you for a witness.
So do I.
Look, this is none of my business, but why don't you two guys just forget it? You know this kind of thing never gets anybody anywhere.
Well, you saw the way he roughed me up.
I never even touched him. You heard him refuse to carry out my order, right?
I guess if you both want me, I'll be there. Oh, boy, what a mess.
What really happened here? Failure by an employee to obey a direct order of a supervisor is insubordination. But did Frank, the supervisor, give a direct order to Joe, the employee? If a direct order has been given by the supervisor, did he later, in fact, rescind it and decide to discuss the question with the employee? Was it simply a request rather than an order? If so, how can any plant be run successfully if supervision makes requests of employees which they may refuse? Did the supervisor make it clear to Joe whether he is making a request or giving an order? As far as Joe is concerned, should it really make any difference? There were several mistakes made on both sides. First, the supervisor should make it unmistakably clear to Joe that he is ordered to report to the foreman, Steve, immediately. This can be done politely, but firmly. The supervisor should not argue with the employee, should not discuss another foreman with the employee, and certainly should not plead with him. Even though Joe would be working temporarily in a lower job classification under Foreman Steve, most labor agreements provide for his regular rate of pay while doing such temporary work in a lower classification. Under no circumstances should the supervisor touch the employee while both are obviously angry. Such touching with the friendliest intention could obviously be misinterpreted by the employee. Of course, if Joe's story is believed, the supervisor is clearly in the wrong. If Joe was given an order to report to Steve, he should have done so immediately. It's not up to Joe to argue about it, to berate Steve, to tell the supervisor he had to wait to collect the World Series pool, or to refuse to do the work he had done and for which he was qualified simply because it was dirty work and he didn't like it. It's not up to Joe to determine the priority of work and to tell the supervisor he had to get out the Kansas City job. It seems obvious that both Joe the employee and Frank the supervisor lost their tempers. No member of supervision at whatever level should permit himself to lose his temper while talking to any employee. Anger always causes reason to fly out the window, and no management can operate effectively without reason. Both of these men were wrong. If Frank gave Joe an order to report to Steve, and Joe did not do it, under these circumstances, was this a case of insubordination? First of all, a supervisor may give an order politely. He does not have to say, "I order you to do this or to do that." No plant should be run like a dictator's army. The supervisor said he told the employee, "I'm telling you again, go over there and help him out." The disinterested witness stated that the supervisor said, "So now, once again, Won't you go over and help Steve out? This coupled with Joe, the employee's statement, that the supervisor said before there was any question of physical contact. Well, I guarantee you there's one thing I'm not going to do any longer, and that's get on my hands and knees and beg you to give Steve a hand. This would lead me to the conclusion that the supervisor had actually ordered Joe to report to the foreman, Steve. Would you, as management, reach the same conclusion?